John Bayless, D plus. I know you could do better, John.
Yes, Ms. Hawkins.
Garth Jenkins, B minus. You had a B plus on your last geography test, didn't you, Garth?
Yes, Ms. Hopkins.
Well, this is quite an improvement.
Thank you.
Morris Wilkerson, C minus. Very nice, Morris. Geraldine Huberman, C. Congratulations, Geraldine.
Thank you.
Harrison Bergeron, A plus. Harrison, would you stay a moment, please? What are we going to do with you, Harrison? When was your band last adjusted?
I saw my intellectrist just last month.
He increased the intensity?
And the frequency. It doesn't seem to help. Nothing helps.
Well, mustn't get discouraged, Harrison. You know, many students would be tempted to cheat on their tests, purposely give wrong answers. You've got a lot of integrity.
I know. I wish I could get rid of some of it. I feel like such a freak.
Who is your intellectrist?
Dr. Gordon.
Well, he's very good, but maybe just a little old-fashioned. I'm going to suggest your parents they take you to Dr. Lindley. When I first started teaching 4 years ago, my students had the second highest academic average in the state. I was nearly fired. He helped me tremendously.
Come on, baby, light my fire. Come on, baby, light my fire.
This is Cleveland's fourth match point. Jerry's fought off the previous three, but can he hear? Oh, his swing was there, but he failed to connect. Let's look at that again. He's got the jump on it. He's right there. It just gets past him.
Tough one, Jerry. Do you think the committee might have handicapped you too much? This is the loosest strung racket on the circuit.
No excuses. Cleveland just played real consistent. He deserves to win.
Well, you're a real gentleman. Good luck next week in Forest Hills. Congratulations, Cleavon. It's my pleasure to present you with the winner's check of $100.
Frank, in your 35 years as a plumber, you must have had some fascinating experiences.
Oh, yeah, you bet. There was this one time I got a call to fix a bathtub leak, you know, so I go to the house, I knock on the door, this little kid answers the door. And I said, I'm here to fix the bathtub leak. So he lets me in, I go upstairs, I'm fixing the bathtub leak. Just as I'm about finished, the kid's mother comes in. And guess what? She never called me. I made a mistake. Instead of going to 26 Maple Drive, I went to 36 Maple Drive. But they had a bathtub leak too. They both had bathtub leaks.
Doesn't that beat all? Well, thank you, Frank.
Oh yeah, it was so funny.
And be sure to tune in tomorrow to chat with Charlie, when our guest will be Pete Wasserman, a grocery clerk from Provo, Utah.
John Fletcher, homicide. Marion Walensky, tax evasion. DuPont, shoplifting. We'll have more executions coming to you live from San Quentin after this word from our sponsor.
Just because Joanne saw them together in that restaurant doesn't prove anything. Maybe she's a client.
She said they were holding hands and kissing.
Poor Betty. What will you do? Confront him?
What good would it do? Ever since my mastectomy, he's lost interest in me as a woman. He tries to pretend, but a wife knows. There's only one answer.
You mean?
Yes, I'm leaving him.
Checkmate. Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. You can't help it. Hey, you want to go to the malt shop? Joey and the guys said they were going to hang out.
Nah, they don't like having me around. I make them uncomfortable.
No, you don't. Well, only when you say something.
See you in class.
How much is 17 times 14?
238.
Who is the 19th president of the United States?
Rutherford B. Hayes.
Can you help him, doctor?
I'm not sure, Mrs. Bergeron. He was just receiving 4 decibels at intervals of 2.3 seconds. We've determined that increasing the volume or frequency of the corrective intrusions beyond this can result in severe damage to brain functions. However, we've been experimenting with pitch and length as variables. With your permission, I'd like to try to modify Harrison's intrusion in these respects.
If you think it can help, certainly.
What's the square root of 529?
23.
Who discovered radio?
Madam Kerman.
How much is 8 plus 4?
22? 17. 14.
Very good. You're gonna see a big improvement, Harrison.
Sure hope so.
There. I think that'll suit it more than the horn rims, don't you?
Oh, yes. And I like the width. I hate those big, thick ones some of the boys wear nowadays.
Is it comfortable, Harrison? Not too tight?
Yes, fine.
Oh, will it be ready by Tuesday? He meets his fiancée Tuesday.
I'll make sure he has it by then. Almost as handsome as his own man, and that's pretty darn handsome.
Oh, I better face the roast.
Nervous, son?
Well, a little. What if, you know, what if we don't hit it off?
I know how you feel. I remember when I first got to meet your mother. I was up all night wondering, what if the computer screwed up? What if it's picked me somebody I can't stand? But then, your mother walked through the door, and I realized how foolish my fears were. The computer never screws up. It picked the absolute 100% perfect girl for me. And it will for you, too. You'll see.
Jane Starbuck.
Welcome.
It's so nice to meet you both. And this is our son, Harrison.
What a fine-looking young man.
Hello, Harrison.
Ma'am, sir.
And this is our daughter, Alma.
Aren't you lovely?
Say hello, dear.
Hello?
Pleased to meet you.
Yeah, me too.
Well, why don't we go
all sit down?
And have something to drink and get to know each other. Dinner should be ready soon.
Name your poison, Wally.
Oh, a beer would be good.
Man after my own heart, Jane.
Just a ginger ale.
Same for Alma.
So Harrison, how's school?
Well, I'm afraid my grades are a lot higher than I'd like, sir.
Yes, George and I were both average students. I don't know how we ever produced Harrison.
Well, they say the intelligence gene is a hard one to wipe out. It can pop up after three or four generations. But with Alma being a little short-changed on the intellectual side, well, I'm sure their kids will turn out just fine.
Like with Wally and me. No matter how high they turned up his band, he could never get below a B in school. But paired off with me, we have had absolutely average kids. Except, of course, for Alma here.
Yes, the computer's doing a terrific job. I bet by the next century, overachievers like Harrison and underachievers like Alma will be nowhere to be found on this earth.
From your mouth to God's ears.
Oh, dinner's ready. Shall we go to the dining room?
So, what school do you go to?
Harding.
Do you like it?
Mm-mm. Everyone makes fun because I'm stupid.
Some kids are real jerks. You know, sometimes I just want to... You know, but hey, you shouldn't feel bad. I mean, it's not your fault you're stupid any more than it's my fault I'm smart. We can't all be average.
My science teacher says someday we will be.
Yeah, that'll be great. But it's still a long way off. Huh. Anyway, I don't think you're all that stupid.
Thanks. I don't think you're all that smart.
Leaves us both with just a bishop and king. It's a draw.
Yeah.
That's the first time ever you didn't beat me. That new band must be doing you good.
Yeah, I really think it is. And, you know, I had an A minus on my last algebra test. And just a B in history.
That's great. God, I wonder what people did before they had these. It must have been terrible living then.
Yeah.
One thing I don't understand, though, more than half the people in the country, like average or below average, they don't need bands, but they have to wear them anyway, even though they don't buzz or anything.
I guess it's so that people like us who need to wear them don't feel different from others, so we don't feel bad.
Yeah, right. Boy, what a great system. We sure are lucky.
Yeah.
The exact national average weight of engagement rings.
Where do diamonds come from?
Well, they were formed millions of years ago, deep beneath the surface of the Earth, when carbon compounds were compressed at temperatures over 9,000 degrees Fahrenheit and at pressures over 3 million pounds to the square inch.
I meant, like, where do they come from? Like Philadelphia?
Well, different places. Mostly South Africa.
Oh, where's that?
Africa. The southern part.
Oh, my parents said we could live with them until we can afford our own place.
Well, now that's really nice of them, but I don't think we'll need it. My Uncle Pete manages a TV shop, and once I graduate, I can start work there as a salesman.
Is it a good job?
Yeah. My vocational counselor says I should make a really average salesman. But the best part is I'll get to be around TV sets all day.
You really like TV, don't you?
Watch it forever.
But you never watch any program for more than a few seconds. You keep switching channels.
Yeah, see, it's not just the programs I like. It's television itself, the idea of it. A few years ago, I was watching this ballet dancer on some show, and he was dancing just like everybody else. But then a strange thing happened. The strap that held the handicapping weight to his leg broke and the weight fell off. He kept right on dancing. He started leaping high in the air like I'd never seen, turning and twirling almost like he was floating. It was incredible. That's why I watch television. Every time I switch the channel, there's always the chance, the possibility that I'll see something really incredible.
How come nobody ever had to handicap me at something?
Maybe it's because God already did such a good job of it.
Yeah.
What's the name of the period starting with the dissolution of the Soviet Union? Geraldine?
The Great Economic Boom.
Right. And what do we call the period right after the boom? Gar.
The Great Recession.
And what made this recession different from all the others before it? Ned?
It never ended. Just kept going.
Why? Christopher?
I forget.
Harrison. It's all right, Harrison. Go ahead.
In all previous recessions, once the economy bottomed out and production started to increase, unemployment would decrease. But in the Great Recession, because of new and improved technologies, fewer and fewer workers were needed in all sectors. One highly trained worker could do the job of 10. So many people forced from their jobs, traditional economic recovery was impossible.
Exactly. By the year 2025, only 15% of the population had jobs. America was divided into two camps, a highly skilled and educated elite and an unemployed, destitute majority. Now, what happened then? Geraldine.
The people who didn't have jobs started making trouble, like
They'd bomb buildings and kill people and riot and stuff.
Mm-hmm. And that was the beginning of what we now know as class?
The Second American Revolution.
Very good. We'll stop there for today. Oh, Harrison, would you stay a moment? I'm afraid that your grades have started to climb back up again. In fact, they're higher than ever.
I know. Every time my band gets adjusted, I think this time it's going to work. I'm going to be just like everybody else, and then... Why? Why me? It's not fair, damn it! It's not fair! I'm sorry.
It's all right, Harrison. I understand.
I guess I'd better go see Dr. Lindley again.
No, I've already spoken to him. Whatever electrical intrusions he can create with the band, it seems that your brain will always find a way to overcome them. He suggests you see Dr. Eisenstock.
What can he do?
Well, I think he should explain that himself.
It's a very simple procedure. You just create electrical blockages at certain key points. And the brain is forced to reroute messages around these points. These new routes require double or triple the time. All mental processes are slowed down. Intelligence drops dramatically.
Is it risky?
Not at all. The surgery is performed through one very tiny hole built into the skull. He'll be out of the hospital in 2 days.
Well, I suppose we should talk it over with his father.
Mrs. Bergeron, I'm afraid the operation is not optional. The handicapping guidelines make it mandatory in cases like this.
Well, Harrison,
No, it's okay, Mom. I want the operation. It sounds fabulous. Will it really give me average intelligence, Doctor?
Maybe even less than average.
How soon can you do it?
I book surgery for next Wednesday. You come and see me Tuesday afternoon for some final tests and x-rays.
Thank you so much, Doctor.
That's a fine boy you have there, Mrs. Bergeron.
But I like you the way you are. I don't want them to make you different.
Oh, don't worry. It'll still be me. It's just my brain that'll change. It won't last up my life anymore.
But all those smart things you say, they're so beautiful.
But when I say them, you always say you don't understand them.
Yeah. But I still know they're beautiful.
Now, after the revolutionary forces had taken the reins of government, what was their first act? Geraldine?
They made a new constitution.
And what was the first article of this new American constitution? Garb.
All men are not created equal. It is the function of government to render them so.
Right. Today, we are privileged to see the constitution in action in our own classroom. Now, Harrison, as we know, was born with a much greater than average mental capacity. Now, it's not his fault. He's just one of nature's mistakes. But tomorrow, in accordance with the Constitution, that mistake will be rectified. And when Harrison returns to school in a few days, he'll be just like the rest of us. And I know that we all want to wish him good luck. Class?
Good luck, Harrison!
I don't see any problem. I'm sure it'll all turn out fine. Hospitals, tomorrow. 7 a.m. sharp, right?
Doctor, you don't think we could try just adjusting my band again? Give it one last shot? I mean, the operation, it seems so permanent.
It's the only way to help you.
Right. Right, I'll see you tomorrow.
Oh, Harrison, follow your plans for tonight.
I don't know. I guess I'll just stay at home and watch TV. Why?
Well, it's your last night with your natural brain. A very exceptional brain. Have you ever been to a head house?
No! I would never go to a place like that.
They're not illegal, you know. Just places where people can go to enjoy an intellectual stimulation.
But they say people in them
take off their bands.
You don't have to take yours off if you don't want to.
Have you ever been to one?
I go occasionally. But I just thought you might want to, you know, test the limits of your brain power. See what your mind is really capable of. It'll be your last chance.
I don't know, Doctor.
Well, if you do decide to go, here is the address of one in the neighborhood. Clean and well done. Tell them I sent you.
Yes, really well handicapped. Tied going into the fourth quarter. I think Green Bay will pull it out. Even with blinkers on, Metcalf's a much better quarterback. Everything go okay at the doctor's?
Yeah, fine. Dad, can I ask you something?
Of course, son. Anything. You know that. You okay?
I guess. It's just... Everything's going so well for me. I got a great job with Uncle Pete waiting for me. I'm gonna marry a really nice girl. I mean, Alma and I don't seem to have a lot to talk about, but she's nice. I really like her. And thanks to the computer, I'm sure we'll have great kids. Really average. And once I've had the operation, I'll even be average myself. I'll make friends, be like everybody else. I ought to be feeling great. Instead, it's like there's something churning around inside of me. Like I'm gonna boil over, explode. You know what I mean?
I'm sorry, son. Just had a buzz. Lost the thread of what you were saying.
I'm just saying, I've got such a great life ahead of me. Why do I feel so lousy when I think about living it?
Oh! Did you see that pass? Metcalf is really something.
Forget about the damn football. I need to talk to somebody.
What? Oh, right. Right. Forgive me, son. Where were we? You were at the doctor's today,
it's
right?
It's okay. It's not important. You enjoy the game.
You sure you're okay, son?
Yeah. Yeah, fine, Dad.
Yes?
Dr. Eisenstock gave me your address.
Any friend of his is welcome here. What's your name, dear?
Harrison Bergeron.
Well, come right in, Harrison. Care for a drink, dear?
No. Thank you, no.
Want to get right to it, huh? So, any particular field of study you care to explore this evening?
Not sure.
Well, then let me introduce you to some of our hostesses. This is Rebecca, 19th century German philosophy, Hegel, Nietzsche. This is Myra, quantum theory. Jennifer, Cubism and Post-Impressionism. And Philippa, our chess expert.
Chess? I like chess.
Good. Philippa, this is Harrison.
Hello.
Hi.
Philippa will take you somewhere you can have some privacy. Oh, Harrison, it is customary to pay before.
Right, how much?
$50 an hour. If you want any extra intellectual stimulation, you can work that out with Philippa.
Never accept Heisenberg's indeterminacy principle. He said God doesn't play dice with the universe.
Here, the theme inverted in the base. Here. It's hard to recognize, but it's
The eighth notes are now quarter notes. Oh, that this too solid flesh would melt. Freud's theory of infant sexuality, of course, shocked his thoughts.
Thus challenging the basic tenets of Kane's theory.
In here. Any particular opening you'd like to explore?
No, whatever. What did she mean downstairs about special intellectual stimulation?
Well, if you like, I could play without my band.
But that's a transgression. You could be executed.
We're alone in here.
What if the police should come?
Then that light will give me plenty of time to put it on again.
How do you know I wouldn't report you?
Oh, you wouldn't do that. Now would you?
I might. I might.
Well, let's find out.
But don't! Are you crazy?
Well, Harrison, are you gonna report me? There's a telephone downstairs. Call the police.
What are you trying to do to me? If I don't report you, I'm not doing my duty as a citizen. And if I do...
They'll shoot me. Make up your mind. Oh, hurry. You only paid for an hour.
Move.
It won't be much of a contest if you keep your band on.
Oh, yeah? Well, we'll see about that. There's nothing I can do. You have mate in three. That combination with the rook sacrifice, it was just beautiful. I never knew chess could be so beautiful.
Thank you, but who knows how the game would have turned out if you hadn't been saddled with your band. We still have 30 minutes. You want to find out?
No, thank you very much, no. That's amazing. You're incredible.
Are you sure about that band? People do it here all the time.
Yes, I'm sure.
Afraid I might still beat you? Even without the band? Afraid to find out you're not really as smart as you think. Or afraid to find out you really are as smart as you think.
No. I mean, I don't know.
Why did you come here?
My doctor suggested it. I'm having brain surgery tomorrow that'll lower my intelligence.
They're doing the operation on you tomorrow. You'll never be the same again, don't you know that?
Of course I know.
Well, don't you just... once in your life, want to know what you're capable of? Just once. Know how it feels to use the mind you were born with freely and fully.
Well, sure. But it's a transgression.
No one will know. Obviously, I'm not going to report you. Come on, Harrison. Find out who you really are. To be honest, I'd kind of like to know, too. Here, let me...
What? No!
Why?
Because it's not right! Oh, no, it's the police! Hurry, put your band back on!
It's all right, don't worry!
I don't understand. What's going on?
You go home and sleep. Tomorrow, you'll understand.
But your band is off. Why didn't they arrest you?
Okay. Tomorrow. I like him.
I like him.
Yes, so do I. Has the anesthetic worn off yet?
I think so.
Bring him in.
Hello, Harrison.
Oh, Dr. Eisenstock. Is the operation over yet?
There was no operation.
Why not? What happened?
Well, after you were checked into the hospital this morning and administered the anesthetic, you were brought here.
Where?
The National Administrative Center. I told you last night everything would be explained to you today.
That's why you're here.
Who's he?
Edward Platson, Chief Administrative Officer. It's a pleasure to meet you, Harrison. I know this is all very puzzling for you. I'll explain as briefly as I can. As you know, since the second American Revolution, America has been striving to create a truly egalitarian society. A society where no one has to be envious of anyone for anything. A society of average people. The problem is that to run such a society requires enormous skill and intelligence. There are certain high administrative functions that the average person is simply incapable of performing.
You mean like senator or president?
Good Lord, no. Anyone with average intelligence or less can handle those. But the people who supervise the economy, run the railroads, airlines, communications, manufacturing, they unfortunately can't be average. They need to be, well, frankly, superior.
And how many superior people are needed?
Surprisingly few, under 3,000. You were brought here because we want you to be one of us.
Me?
Our recruitment department has been watching you for some time. Your intellectual gifts are considerable. But what makes you truly special, as you proved last night, is your commitment to the just society we are building.
You mean the head house? The chest that was all some sort of test?
Exactly, and you passed it magnificently.
What if I had failed? What would have happened to me?
Exactly what happened to all the others who were there and transgressed. You would have been executed.
And you were doing everything you could to get me to transgress. To get me executed!
Yes, but she was hoping she wouldn't succeed.
Thanks a lot.
Anytime.
Very few young men and women possess the qualities we require here. It's very important to us that you choose to join us.
I have a choice?
Of course, that's why you were brought here like this. This is a secret facility. The general public doesn't even know it exists. The idea that it's only possible to have true equality by fostering inequality might be a trifle difficult for them to grasp. If you decide to return to your previous life, you will leave here under anesthetic as you came.
How do you know I wouldn't tell people about it?
You would never do anything that might harm your country. And if you did say anything, people would assume it was a delusion caused by the surgery you supposedly just had.
You mean I wouldn't have to have the operation?
We would never destroy such an exquisite intelligence.
And if I choose to join?
Your family and friends will be told that you died of surgery. You'll start a whole new life. There'll be many sacrifices. You'll never again be able to see or communicate with those you love. You will not be allowed to have children, since that sort of thing would clearly lead to a permanent, privileged aristocracy. But there are rewards, too. You'll be free to exercise your mental faculties to their fullest.
But to never see my mother and father again? Make them think I died? Put them through that? No, I couldn't live with that.
30 million people died in the Second Revolutionary War and its aftermath. It could happen again if we fail here. Could you live with that?
I love my parents and my home. But I guess I have to realize that the only reason my home and so many more like it exist at all is that people like you have been willing to do what you're asking of me. It wouldn't be right to refuse.
Thank you. We'll show you your apartment.
30 million?
It seemed like a nice round number.
Not crazy about the early egalitarian decor. Expecting something a little more out of the ordinary.
Well, yeah. But no, this is perfect. I mean, we should live just like everybody else, not like some privileged class.
You say so. Actually, we do get one special privilege. One we need in order to perform our functions. May I?
Oh, yeah, sure. Oh, wow! Wow! Oh, can we play?
Another time. But here are some books on chess, and novels and biographies, and some videos of old movies and TV shows and concerts you're not allowed to watch. Don't stay up all night. Tomorrow morning at 8, I'll start taking you around to the different departments. We have to find out exactly where your talents and interests lie so that we can put you to work as soon as possible.
Right. Oh, look. I'm sorry I got angry with you before. Back in the head house, you were just doing what had to be done. It's an important job, and you do it great.
Thank you. Everything I do, I try to do great. See you tomorrow.
And the singers and the actors in those movies and TV shows, they're all so incredible.
Yes, there were a lot of show-offs back then.
Yeah.
Speaking of show-offs, you've got a hole in your bathroom?
Pleasure to meet you, young fella. Well, you've come to good time. We're about ready to select the next governor of Louisiana. You know, in the old days, politicians came to power through election rather than selection. The candidates would spend a fortune trying to convince voters they was the best one for the job. Nowadays, of course, we know that nobody's any better than anybody else. And if he is, well, he does his damnedest to hide the fact. So elections are pointless. Well, people said it never made any difference who won anyway. Well, they're all the same, everybody used to say. What all elections did was make sure nobody got too big for their britches. Became a tyrant. Our process does that just as well and saves a whole mess of time and energy and money.
Makes a lot of sense.
Oh, you bet. Say, how'd you like to pick the next governor of Louisiana? I mean, of course, assuming that's all right with the other members of the Selectoral Committee.
Great idea, yeah. Well, sure, what do I do?
Well, the names of all the adults in Louisiana have been randomly correlated with numbers inside this year's computer. You just pick any number up to 8 digits. What do I do?
Go ahead.
Genevieve Wolcher, Treeport, married, 3 kids, waitress.
Hello?
Is that Miss Genevieve Wolcher?
Uh-huh.
One moment, please. Give her the news. Now go on, you pick her, you tell her.
Do it, Harrison.
Go ahead.
Mrs. Wolcher, ma'am, it's my honor to inform you that, you're the next governor of Louisiana.
Oh, me? Oh, really?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, I'll get that bumping. Jenny, you go get your daddy out of my bathroom. I'm gonna be governor. Douglas, don't you put that stuff in your sister's hair. Oh, when do I start governing?
Someone will be contacting you shortly to work out the details of your inauguration.
Well, I have time to get my hair done.
Oh, absolutely. Well, goodbye for now, Governor Wolcher.
Bye. Oh, thanks, Douglas, I told you to put that down. You hear me? I'm governor.
Well, I think we ended our coffee break.
Yep. This electrical system is so great. It's absolutely fair. Every kid in America knows that he or she has a real chance to be president someday.
Right. No matter how big an idiot he or she happens to be.
Exactly.
So before instituting any new technique or production procedure, a manufacturer must apply to this office. Stephen, what is this?
Application from a bottle manufacturing plant in Seattle. By just alternating clockwise and anti-clockwise rotation of this feeding device, they're able to triple output. It's such a simple idea. Beautiful.
Yes. You are refusing them permission to use it, of course.
Well, of course.
If it wasn't for the Office of Economic Suppression, this country would be right back where it was before the revolution. Man's ingenuity, his ability to produce more and more efficiently, was throwing millions out of work, creating social turmoil. Just as the physical size of the dinosaur caused his extinction, so the development of man's intellectual potential was threatening his survival. But we've learned to keep that in check. We found that the best balance between full employment and productivity was achieved in the 1950s, and that's the era we use as our model.
You know, looking at those tapes last night, I realized that everything today looks an awful lot like the 1950s. Is that just because of the economic thing?
And because that's when America was apparently happiest. Or at least that's how people who were alive then remember it. So after the revolution, the geniuses who ran the new government tried to make the country look and sound like that again. Figuring that if people look happy, they'd feel happy.
Seems to work.
Harrison, when I called the government geniuses, I was being sarcastic.
I know. That doesn't mean it's not true.
Hello, Harrison. How goes the orientation?
Well, there's a lot to take in. It's pretty mind-boggling.
I think your mind will withstand considerable boggling. But I'm sure you'll have a lot of questions. And when you do, feel free to come see me at any time, please.
Thank you, sir.
Try the bacon burger sometime. It's excellent.
He seems like a nice guy.
Guess he's less of an asshole than most of the others here.
Oh, well, high praise indeed coming from you.
Hey, I'll do the jokes.
Sorry, it's contagious. Hey, after we're through tonight, how about that chess game you promised me?
You won't be happy till you demolish me, will you?
No. It's not right for me to feel like that, is it?
My apartment. 8. Come on. Back to work.
Fewer than 100,000 law enforcement officers, civic, state, and federal, in the whole nation. Less than 3% of what there used to be.
Wow.
Harrison's sincerest expression of admiration.
Forgive me for interrupting.
Quite all right. My assistant, Henry Wayne. Harrison Bergeron, Philippa's new recruit.
Nice to meet you. I've been talking to Governor Leslie for half an hour. He refuses to stop the execution. Maybe if you spoke to him.
Pointless, Henry. He can't stand up to the pressure he's been getting from the League.
But it's barbaric!
Henry, the people make the laws. We're only here to advise and help administer it.
This is the first execution to be held under the new law passed by the Texas legislature extending capital punishment to traffic offenses. Francis Narrows is about to pay the ultimate penalty for making an illegal left-hand turn. Beside me is Miss Lorraine Newbound, head of the Houston chapter of the League Against Non-Capital Punishment. Miss Newbound, you of course are in favor of the new law.
Absolutely. I just wish it included non-movement violations.
Parking offenses.
Why not? A crime is a keep criminals alive.
Thanks.
Cook the crooks! Cook the crooks!
Thank you, Mr. Bell.
Cook the crooks!
Over to you, Brad Cooper.
Cook the crooks! Cook.
Thank you, Barry. The warden looks about ready to throw the switch. Oh, yes, there goes the current.
Executions were rare events.
Why did things change so drastically?
Well, in the old days, there were endless debates among experts about how to fight crime. More prisons, more police, gun control, better rehabilitation, job counseling, training programs, nothing seemed to work. When the average people took over the government, they realized they weren't smart enough to come up with a way to fight crime. So they decided to just fight criminals. It's a popular bumper sticker. Don't fight crime, fight criminals. They started off by executing all murderers, first degree or manslaughter, crazy or sane. Then they extended the law to cover all violent crimes, then eventually non-violent crimes too. To their simple minds, it seemed that if they eliminated criminals, they might eliminate crime too.
Simple is the operative word.
Well, be fair, Henry. It worked, given that. There's a lot of fat policemen sitting around in stations watching soap operas in this country.
Excuse me, ma'am, but I watch television a lot. There seem to be executions going on all the time.
Most of them are reruns. We don't advertise the fact. It would hurt ratings, and we want people to watch for the deterrent value. No, there is very little crime out there. See, it used to be that about 7% of the people committed about 70% of the violent crimes. Once they got eliminated, crime pretty much did too.
Yes. And how many innocent people got eliminated in the process?
We'll never know. On the other hand, we'll never know how many innocent lives were saved either. What we do know is that the system, simplistic and brutal as it is, has just about eradicated crime.
Well, why don't we just kill everybody? That way we'll eradicate crime totally.
Interesting idea.
Arrivederci, Mr. Cisneros. This electrocution has been brought to you by General Electric. And bring your things to death.
That bothered you, didn't it?
Yeah. It really did. Strange. It never did before. It must have something to do with the band being off. You know, I know this sounds terrible, but while that guy was being electrocuted, I found myself wondering if laws could ever be wrong.
Surely you jest.
You think they could be?
Of course they can be, you twit. Wrong and stupid and brutal and vicious. Just like the men who make them.
No, they can't. They can't be wrong or right. They can only seem that way to people. To most people, the laws are right. So who are we, a small minority, to place our morality above theirs? We're here to serve people. Not rule over them. Scene 8. Looks like a draw.
I guess so. All that work for nothing.
No, not for nothing. It was a terrific game.
You ever play chess with Alma?
No. Nah, she was great, but... but not the way you are.
But
On some music. I'll make coffee.
Jehoshaphat. You should try them too sometimes.
Well, I do, but see, I believe language should be precise, and one wow is equal to three gollies or 7.2 jumping Jehoshaphats. So wow was clearly the only appropriate expletive for the moon language.
Okay, what about holy shit?
I prefer to reserve that for the appassionata. Yeah, I guess I better go. Starting early again tomorrow, don't we?
So don't watch those old tapes all night again. Harrison? Before we exchanged queens tonight, there was a position where you could have had maiden four and they didn't make the key move. But you saw it, didn't you? Why? Why did you just play for the draw?
I remembered how I felt when I lost to you. It hurt. I didn't want to hurt you. What are you doing?
Taking you to my bed.
Your bed?
It's where I sleep, among other things.
Well, sex before marriage, it's wrong.
Only for people who wear metal bands. And you don't anymore. Unless, of course, you're wearing one down there. A moment ago, it felt like you might be.
No. No. May I come in? Philippa? I would like to come to your bed. Now, I thought it through, and for people outside here, it is wrong to have sex before marrying, because the computer is trying to pair people up so that they'll produce average children. But in here, we're not going to have children, so we can pair up with whoever we want. Plus which, insofar as it fosters good relations between administrators, it's obviously beneficial to society as a whole.
Men have given me many reasons for wanting to pair up with me. We shared the same taste in music. They liked my eyes. My perfume intoxicated them, or they were just horny as hell. All of which I found excellent reasons. But I'm damned if I'm dropping my drawers for someone who wants to screw me because it may prove beneficial to society. Out!
We, you know.
Out!
Oh. I share your taste in music. I like your eyes. Your perfume intoxicates me, and I'm horny as hell. Have you been with a lot of men?
How many would you consider a lot?
Three.
Is it important to you?
No. I have to realize that the moral restrictions placed on society don't apply to administrators who I should just shut up, shouldn't I?
That may be the smartest thing you ever said.
Wow!
The moral.
Dedicated to eradicating not only differences in mental capacity, but differences in appearance as well. Look at John here. How would you compare him to me?
I don't know.
Or Sam and Leon. Or Jeffrey and Max. How would you describe how they appear?
I can't.
Of course not. Once it would have been easy. One would just say, John's thinner than me. Sam's darker than Leona. Jeffrey's taller than Max. Mitch is freckled. Harry is bald.
Thinner? Taller? Freckled? I don't know those words.
Nor does anyone else today. All words relating to physical characteristics were eliminated from the language decades ago. It was thought that if we removed a person's ability to describe the differences between him and others, in time he wouldn't even notice them. And it's worked to an extent. But it's only a stopgap measure. Just as we're using genetics to eliminate upper and lower extremes of intelligence in our future citizens, so we're programming the mating computers to match fat with thin, dark-skinned with light, round-eyed with narrow-eyed. One day, one glorious day, there'll be no reason for any American to dislike or envy any other because of the way he looks, because we'll all look the same.
That's incredible.
I suppose it is a rather startling concept.
Well, not really, sir. I mean, America was conceived as a melting pot, and you're just bringing the pot to the boil.
Yes! I like that. To the boil. Excellent. It's been a pleasure. Congratulations, Philippa. A truly exceptional recruit.
Yes. Sometimes it's hard to believe he's real.
Today in the archives, I found this great movie by some incredible guy, Orson Welles. It's called Citizen Kane. I'll bring it over Friday night so we can watch it together.
Oh, I can't Friday. I've got a recruiting session.
The head house?
Yeah. What's the matter?
The thought of you listening to Beethoven or watching Hamlet with someone else, it's really hard for me to take.
Oh, come on. It's not like I was doing this with them.
It is to me. Do you play chess with them too? No, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, it's just... Ever since the ban came off, it's like I don't just get thoughts I never had before, but feelings, too. You know what I mean?
Yes. I've had one or two of those myself. Annoying little buggers, aren't they?
But I shouldn't give in to them. I mean, what you do is very necessary. You must get a lot of satisfaction whenever you find a really good recruit.
Well, not always as much as I'm getting in your case. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Let's get married.
We
can't. The chief told you that when you joined.
No, he just said we couldn't have children.
But if people marry, live together, set up a home, they're going to want children to complete it. Something called human nature. So marriage is a no-no too.
Right. Only makes sense. Good sense. Excellent fucking sense!
What's that? Could it be that this glorious new world of ours is imperfect in some way?
No. It's just me that's imperfect.
No, baby. You're perfect. A perfect idiot.
I've heard many good reports about him, and I do hope he'll think seriously about joining our department.
Thank you. I didn't realize there were male recruiters. I didn't see any at the headhouse.
Well, for women, we use a sort of an escort service. Women for their illicit pleasures in a more private setting.
Well, I'd certainly feel privileged to be one of you, but I'm not sure I can handle it. I mean, tempting people to remove their bands, knowing what will happen to them if they do. I've seen Philippa after she's had a session with someone who couldn't resist her and failed the test. She tries to hide it, but I know how much it hurts her. You know, it must take tremendous dedication and strength of character to do what you do. Plus the ability not to crack under the pressure of knowing that the well-being of the nation depends upon your doing your job successfully. I truly admire you all.
On second thought, Philippa. I'm not sure Harrison ought to become a recruiter. If that woman had to resist him in order to prove herself, we'd never recruit anybody.
What's this?
An update on your family. We get them every few months.
My dad finally got the power mower he's wanted for years.
Don't read it. It's easier to think of them as dead.
Oh. I'm sorry, but your parents?
No, I clipped it out of a magazine.
Were you very close to them?
Look, I don't want to talk about my family. I don't have a family anymore, okay?
Hey. I'll be your family.
Your mother's or mine?
Well, they're both excellent pies, but I'm sorry, dear. I have to say that yours is the best.
Oh, Harry!
Mother!
Asky, you said you like my pie better than hers.
Well, I'm sorry.
That's all right. At least I know where I stand. If you like her pie best, then here. Enjoy!
What do you think, Jennifer?
It's certainly nothing original in the concept. The writing is mundane, the acting is pedestrian.
Yeah.
I like it. It could go nicely Tuesday night after the neighbors.
I agree. There were a couple of fairly clever, sophisticated jokes, but I'm sure broadcast standards can read them out. Let's go to 13.
Okay.
What did you think, Harrison?
Me? Well, it was okay. It's sort of like every other show on.
Yes, they did a fine job.
Yes, sir, may I ask a question? Why do the more sophisticated and clever parts have to be censored?
Because it may be over the heads of some of the viewers. If people feel they're missing some of the jokes, they'll feel inferior. And we can't have that, can we?
No, I guess not.
Even in the old days, TV tended to descend to the level of the least common denominator. Not intentionally. Just the nature of the beast. But occasionally, shows of some quality would sneak through. We, of course, have made a conscious decision not to air anything that can't be appreciated by everyone watching. So we've managed to eliminate quality altogether. We're extremely proud of that.
Extremely proud.
I love television.
Yes. Television is like really fine brandy. It doesn't take much to make you vomit.
No, no way!
But, Mr. President, the Premier is only asking for 24 hours. He wants the approval of the Moroccan Parliament. He fears civil war if he acts without their backing.
Track him! I told him 2 weeks ago, if he didn't dismantle that factory under our supervision, we'd bomb the shit out of it. He's got 10 minutes to agree. If not, bomb the way!
But, sir, the installation is only 5 miles outside of Rabat. The fallout could kill millions.
That's what they get for trying to build an H-bomb when we told them not to. Those cocksuckers got to learn not to fuck with us. 9 minutes!
Yes, sir. Inform the Premier and tell Missile Control to make final preparations for the strike.
Will there really be millions of people killed?
That's what happened when we bombed the installation in Belgrade 10 years ago.
I was only 8 then, but I remember all the parades.
Yes. America was celebrating making the Earth a safer place.
By killing millions?
Not entirely logical, I grant you. But the average person thinks we're the superpower. If someone doesn't do what we want, make them. And the president is an average person.
Have we bombed any other countries since Belgrade?
No. Our policy, brutal as it is, does seem to...
work?
Yes. The rest of the world seems to have learned, to use the president's stirring words, that they can't fuck with us. But this Moroccan business is different. With the border dispute with Algeria and the unrest in his military, the premier is in an impossible situation. The president, I fear, does not appreciate the complexity of the matter. He may be an average person, but other leaders are far from average. They are subtle, sophisticated men. Dealing with them requires great skill and patience and diplomacy.
So, the Moroccan premier has agreed to the terms of the president's ultimatum.
As I was saying.
Those soldiers, they say Joe's not present. Oh, gentle Romeo. If thou dost love, pronounce it faithfully.
Does it bother you that America won't ever produce a Shakespeare?
Why should it? We've had centuries of great writers and philosophers and artists and composers. There's far more books and records and tapes of movies and TV shows than any one person can enjoy in a lifetime. Who needs more geniuses?
Yeah, I guess you're right.
I was joking, dummy. How can there be too many Shakespeares or Chopins or Rembrandts or Orson Welles?
What are you so angry about?
About you. How can you not see what self-serving hypocrites the people running this madhouse are? Or what a dull, colorless blob they've turned this country into? How can someone as smart as you be so impossibly gullible and blind and stupid? And above all, how in hell can I find your gullibility, blindness, and stupidity such incredibly endearing and appealing qualities?
Are you saying you don't really believe in the system we're trying to create here?
Oh, you are swift, aren't you? Yes, I'm saying the system sucks. This society sucks, and above all, this place sucks.
But if you felt like that, why didn't you let them recruit you?
I was 16. I was like you, full of dreams and ideals and similar bullshit. See, I thought I was embarking on a glorious crusade. I thought the people here were gods, striving to create a beautiful, just, and perfect world.
How long was it before you changed your mind?
Half an hour.
No. I don't believe it. If that's the way you feel, how can you keep going back to the head house and doing what you do?
What's my choice? Let them put that band back on me and live my life with tapioca pudding for a brain?
You couldn't do that. Tempt those guys to transgress, knowing what it means. If deep down you didn't believe that what we're trying to do is right and good. You're not that sort of person. If you were, I couldn't love you like I do.
Send him in. Come right in, Harrison. Sit down.
Thank you, sir.
Feeling well?
Yes, sir.
Good. I understand you've completed your orientation. Are there any particular administrative departments that have especially whetted your interest? I can't promise anything, but we'll try to take your preferences into consideration.
Well, sir, I've always loved television. I think it would be great to be involved in it.
Ah. Television is the thread that holds together the fabric of our society. The average person, and there are a lot of those these days, spends a fifth of his life in front of the TV. What he sees determines what he believes, what he feels, how he judges right and wrong, and thus how he behaves. Television programming is a grave trust. As it happens, there's an opening in the department. I'll speak to the administrator about you.
Thank you, sir. That'd be great.
I was just going to have some coffee. Please join me. Well, you've been here a month now. What do you think about the world?
That's very impressive. You set out to create a just society, and you're doing it.
And how are you adapting to life here? Happy?
Yes. It's just...
Go on, I want to know.
The rule about us not having kids, it's really hard to accept. I mean, is it absolutely necessary?
We administrators have special privileges, but only because we happen to have been born with unusual mental capacities. If that's not equality, at least it's equality of opportunity. But if people became administrators just because their parents are, and that's what must happen because people will do anything to ensure their offspring obtain the privileges they enjoy, equality vanishes. Justice vanishes. So hard as the rule is, we must accept it, all of us. Do you understand?
Intellectually, yes. But emotionally...
Yes, that always takes time. Any other problems? Please, tell me.
It's just... Every time I listen to great music, or read a great novel, or see a great film, it saddens me, knowing that our society will never produce any more of them. I know it's the function of government to render people equal, so we have to eliminate those with talent and genius, but still...
Saddens you? Me too, Harris. Oh, how it saddens. Rachmaninoff's second piano concerto. I adore it. How do you imagine I feel knowing that I'm striving to create a world in which no Rachmaninoff will ever be born? But it has to be. Not because of some words in the Constitution. Here, look. The Bible tells us not to covet, but we do. It's in our damn genes. We covet not just our neighbor's ass, lands, and possessions, but also his talent, intelligence, and appearance. And once covetous, we hate. And when we hate, this is what happens, as it has for thousands of years. Well, it's got to stop. If I have to choose between this and eliminating this, I'll strangle Rachmaninoff myself. Take this and study it well. I'll let you know after I've spoken to the communications administrator.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
controls television, controls the nation. So naturally, we've instituted stringent security procedures. Open, please.
You are recognized.
Every moment of every show on every channel, seen anywhere in the country, taped or live, network or local, is routed through this room. It's totally secure. 20-foot thick steel walls that could withstand a nuclear blast. If I flip that switch, that door closes, and no one, no army can get in. As a member of this department, you have enormous responsibility.
I'll try to be worthy of it, sir.
I'm sure. Come, we'll teach the door to recognize you.
It's really great. The administrator has me in on all the programming decisions now. Yesterday, I even came up with a new idea for a show.
Congratulations.
Now, it's just a kid's show, but it could be cute. The idea is to use old fairy tales. Now, nobody does that today because, you know, they're all about kings and princesses and giants.
Not ideal role models for kids in an egalitarian society.
Right. Like the ugly duckling that turns into a swan. Now, why does it have to be a swan? Why can't it just be a normal, average duck? Or the frog that gets the girl to kiss it? Now why does he have to turn into a handsome prince? Let him turn into a shoe salesman. You know, I really like the idea of doing something for kids. Especially since we can't, you know.
Right. Harrison, let's get out.
What do you mean?
Get out, escape. When I leave to go to the head house tonight, there's only one guard. I could distract him, you could sneak by, and we could just run, just cross into Canada.
Why would we want to go to Canada?
Because they've got real people there, leading real lives.
Well, that'd be more real than trying to make the world a better place.
This is more real. I'm pregnant, you idiot.
Pregnant? Are you sure? But how?
Remember when you stuck that little thing of yours into that little thing of mine?
I thought you took precautions.
Not always.
Pregnant. Pregnant.
Oh! That's incredible!
But they said we couldn't have babies.
Apparently they were wrong.
Was this happened here before?
It happens all the time.
What do?
They give you a pill to get rid of it.
Abort it? No. No!
That's why we have to get out of here.
Yeah, but just run away? No, that can't be right.
Is it right for them to kill our baby because of some stupid rule?
Okay, it's not a stupid rule. People here are allowed to have kids. They'll be a permanent, privileged ruling class, and that's not right or fair. Rule is not stupid.
Great. Then you want us to obey it?
No! I don't know what I want! I need time to think.
We don't have time. If we're gonna escape, tonight might be our only chance. Look, I have a meeting to go to. I'll come to your place when I'm through. You... Thank you. Try to escape with me.
I can't.
You You'd rather destroy our baby?
I can't do that either.
It's one or the other. You have to decide.
I can't.
I have to go.
Looks like you've got me again.
It's the band. We'd have a much better game without it. Would you excuse me for a moment, please?
I can help if you'll just trust me.
She found out she was pregnant, and she...
She wants to have the baby. Stupid girl.
No, we want to have the baby. Whatever she's guilty of, so am I.
If only it come to me! Damn!
What will happen when she's found?
If we find her first. As you recall, you were brought here under an anesthetic. All recruits are. While they're unconscious, tracking devices are surgically implanted inside their bodies. Don't worry, we'll find them.
Philippa. Hey. No, it's okay. He knows everything. He wants to help us.
By killing our baby.
Philippa. Let go!
Philippa, listen to me. I won't harm the baby. There's another way.
What do you mean?
You'll come back with us. There'll be some questions. We'll report him missing from the head house. I'll say you're on a secret assignment for me. In a few months, I'll devise another assignment for you. Supposedly, you'll be sent overseas. Actually, you'll go to live with a couple near Houston. They want a child very badly, but are unable to conceive. You'll have the baby there. Then you'll return to the center. The couple will raise the child as their own. When he gets to be 17, he'll be recruited and brought to the center. He won't know you're his parents. But you'll see him, know him, enjoy him. Love him or her.
You can do all this?
Power inevitably has its perquisites.
Still, there must be risk.
I can do it. I've done it before for my own child.
But this isn't your child.
No, it's my grandchild. Your mother died only a year before you were recruited and brought to the center. How proud she would. How she would have adored you. You're so like your mom.
I could have been.
Yourself, and you'll announce the winner next week. And if you'd like to be a contestant on Sing America Sing, write us at this address. See you next week.
Perfect television. Harrison?
Oh, yeah. But maybe before each contestant sings, the host should chat with them a bit to let the audience get to know them.
The host did chat with the contestants.
Oh. I must have dozed off.
See? I told you it was perfect television.
Oh,
please.
Chess? I'll be away a long time. You better beat me while I can. What's the matter, Harrison?
Something's not right. You, me, your father, the baby, something's just not right.
Lots of things aren't right. At least for once, whatever the hell is not right, it's doing some good.
We're supposed to be creating a world where all people are equal. Not some, not most, not all, but one or two.
What is it you want? Do you want your baby to be killed? Do you want me to be killed? Would that make you happy?
After the ban came off, I started having doubts about whether there's a God. Tonight, before I came here, I went to the chapel, and all I could do was keep repeating, thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. But how I feel doesn't change anything. Either there's equality or there's not. And if there's not, what's this all for? Why are millions of people living their lives with half a brain? Why are people in here giving up their mothers and fathers the right to have kids? And how many people have had to go through the hell we just did, only without the happy ending because they don't happen to have a daddy who runs the place? You're right. The system sucks. And it sucks.
Our baby will live.
Under a system that sucks.
I know. But you can't fight. City Hall.
Program to bring you a public service bulletin. Hurricane Walter is moving toward the Atlantic coast at 30 miles per hour. Meteorologists can't yet predict exactly where it will strike, but we urge everyone to take precautions along the entire southern coastline.
Tough to operate these things?
Nah. You look through here. You got focus, tilt, pan. Dolly. Hey, baby, you're a cameraman.
How many channels carried that bulletin?
All of them.
You have to flick like 200 controls?
No, this master connects them all to the studio feed.
Good. I wouldn't want you to get switcher's cramp.
Oh. Dostoevsky.
I love you. Open, please.
Yes.
Ah, sure thing.
All right, everyone, out. Hail out. Marty, Phil, out. Jerome, you'll make me use this.
Now, Harrison, why don't you give me that thing?
This?
Yeah.
Sure.
How do you feel? You seem deranged.
But it's hard to tell when someone's pointing a gun at you.
Where the hell is the window booth?
They're just outside.
Keep them there. I worry about this to anyone.
Got it.
What do you want me to do?
Bring Phil up here. Hello, Harrison.
Hello, Chief Administrator.
What exactly are you doing?
I'm starting the third American Revolution. Maybe this time we'll get it right.
A revolution all by yourself. And how do you plan to accomplish that?
Ooh, gonna have a little chat with the country? The whole country.
Harrison, it's not too late to stop this. I can say it was done to test our security. I can arrange everything.
With your power and its inevitable perquisites, I'm sure you can.
Is that what this is about? The fact that I intervened to save the lives of the woman you love and your unborn child? Is that a crime?
No, no, no. The crime is sacrificing 300 million minds in the name of a fairness and justice that you and your friends feel free to violate whenever it suits you.
We've tried to use our power for the good of all. But yes, sometimes we abuse it. Power corrupts. People are people.
Not outside the center, they're not. You won't let them be.
Disappoint me, Harrison. I looked on you as a son.
Thank you. I already have a father. Although we were never allowed to know more than a small part of each other.
Harrison, you mustn't do this. I love you. I want your child to know and love you.
So do I. But if I didn't do this, I wouldn't be worth loving.
You can't succeed. You're just wasting a valuable life.
And you're wasting millions of them. Sorry. Peak viewing time. Gotta get to work.
Harrison, I beg you, just think about what the...
Yeah?
This is Chief Administrator Claxton. Let me speak to the President, please.
Listen, could you call back? He's watching his favorite soap. Hates to be disturbed.
It's urgent. A national emergency.
Okay, but he won't like it. Harry! Harry, you better take this one. Some sort of national, I don't know, whatever. Yeah, come on.
God damn it. God damn it! Now, give me that goddamn thing. This better be important. Ginny just told her husband she's pregnant by another man.
Mr. President, a rebel administrator has taken over the TV master control room. He'll begin broadcasting his message over all channels any moment.
What the fuck you want me to do about it?
Order the National Guard, the police, and the army to go house to house and smash every TV set.
Are you a little fucking mind? You can't tell the people TV. They come and string me up, and I wouldn't much blame them either. Play a log on TV, and I couldn't get one past either or one of you. Why don't you just break into the control room and waste them?
We'd have to cut through solid steel with lasers, and it'd take forever.
Well, you goddamn well better get dirt, huh?
Hello, everybody. Sorry for interrupting your usual Sunday night viewing, and please, don't try to change the channels. I'm on all of them.
Bring in the lasers.
My name is Harrison Bergeron. I work here in the Federal Administration Center. I've illegally taken charge of this master control room in order to get you to overthrow this whole system of forced equalization. The people who came up with this system had good intentions. They wanted to get rid of envy, which can lead to many terrible things. And they did it, which is great. But what have you had to give up in return? You don't even know, do you? Well, as long as I can stay on the air, I'm gonna show you. Show you some of the things people are capable of, what you might be capable of too.
But in order for you to understand what you're gonna see, you'll have to do something you've been told is wrong. You'll have to take off your bands. Please, take them off. It's not wrong. If it was, why would we administrators be allowed to walk around without them? That's right. This whole so-called society of equals is based on the unequal privilege of a special few. Take them off. I bet once you do, you'll never allow any government to make you put it on again. Now, what I want to show you are videotapes made before the revolution of athletes, musicians, singers, dancers, actors, comedians. They're unlike anything you've ever seen before. But I better warn you, you're going to envy them like crazy. I know I do. But I think seeing and hearing them is worth a little envy. Now, this first tape is from a concert from the 1980s of one of the greatest singers alive then. If you haven't taken off your bands yet, please, do it now.
What's going to happen to him?
At the moment, I don't know what's going to happen to anybody. You, me, anybody. How long?
Hard to tell. 30 hours at least. We're bringing in heavier lasers.
Wow. Now next is a movie made by Charlie Chaplin. Maybe the funniest man of all time. But it's silent. You have to read the words they say. So if you've forgotten how to read, get someone to read them to you.
Any word on disturbances anywhere?
Not yet. Police and military are on alert around the country.
Before I show you any more, can I say a few words to some people who must be pretty surprised to see me up here? See, the families and friends of everyone in the center think they're dead, because the people who run things figure that if you knew there's a place like this where people get these special privileges, you wouldn't stand for it. I hope they're right about that. Anyway, hi, Mom. Hi, Dad. I'm not dead. In fact, it's just the past few months I've ever really been alive. I miss you, and hope we'll all be together again soon without any bands. This next tape is for you, Dad. It's a basketball player called Michael Jordan in action.
Louis, I think this is the beginning of a beautiful friendship.
God, I love that movie.
How soon?
Shouldn't be long.
I don't know how much time I have left in here, and I don't know what's happening outside this room. I hope you've taken off your bands and destroyed them and understood what I've been trying to show you. People aren't all the same, and if you try to make them the same, well, they stop being people. Because see, the most important thing about a person is what makes him different from others. When you love somebody, that's what you really love. I know that, because since I've been here, I've been lucky enough to really love somebody, to know all the things that make her special, and to love them all. And that kind of love, it's the greatest. So when they took away envy, they took away love too. Well, I hope we have time for one more.
Hey,
but I wouldn't bet on it.
Idiot!
Oh. I have to talk to you.
What happened?
Very little, Harrison.
The broadcast. Did people take off their pants?
Many did, but they put them back on right afterwards.
Even after seeing...
all your wonderful tapes? Yes, I'm afraid so. You've done me a great personal service, Harrison. Over the years, I've had considerable, let's call them moral qualms about having deprived people of the joys they might have derived from the sort of things you showed them. There was always a nagging doubt. Could I be one of the bad guys? And I don't want to be one of the bad guys. Now I see I haven't been depriving them of any great joys after all. Although, according to our research, 1.3% of our viewers were moved and touched and delighted by your tapes.
1.3%.
Error margin of 0.2. 12.7 positively disliked what they saw. They were either bored and frustrated because they couldn't understand it, or outraged at what they considered the unconscionable showing off they witnessed.
And the rest?
The other 86% didn't notice any difference between what you showed them and what we've been showing them all these years. To them, it was all just television.
How soon will I be executed?
Actually, that might not prove necessary.
But I transgressed in front of the whole country.
The 1.3% who believed you, while not a large percentage, still amounts to over 2 million people, who could conceivably foment civil unrest. Nothing we couldn't deal with. But you could save us the trouble. If you agreed to, your execution would be moot. It's Philippa's idea. I'll let her explain.
Remember that Orson Welles radio version of War of the Worlds back in the 1930s? He convinced half of America it was being invaded by Martians. You could say that what you did was the same sort of thing.
That it was a hoax?
It was a sort of play that you were just performing.
That none of it was true.
But my family, my friends, they must realize they were lied to about my being dead. They'll know something's phony.
Everyone who knew you has already had the rate of electronic intrusions from their bands triple.
They'll turn into vegetables!
It was either living vegetables or dead meat.
You bastard!
Perhaps. But a humane one, I like to think.
Hey, hey. What you tried to do, it was great. But it didn't work. You have to face it, your revolution is dead. But you don't have to be. You can live with me. And someday with our child. Please, Harrison. Live.
Thank you. Thank you, and welcome to Chat with Charlie. My guest tonight is the young man who, a few nights ago, put on one of the most amazing shows in the history of television. Won't you please welcome Harrison Bergeron. You know, Harrison, many people, me included, thought that what we were seeing on Sunday night was for real. You scared the pants off us.
I'm sorry if I frightened anyone. I only meant to entertain.
So it was all made up, pretense like any other TV movie, right? You never took over any control room. There's no secret headquarters with mysterious people running things and getting special privileges.
Of course not.
And you didn't want people to take off their bands.
No way. We know what happens to people who transgress, and no performer wants to lose his audience.
Still, one thing bothers me. You're such a good actor. Maybe you're acting right now. How can we be absolutely certain what we saw on Sunday wasn't for real?
Because if it had been, I wouldn't be alive now. And I am alive now, aren't I?
Why, that's right. I'd say that was proof positive.
Yes, Charlie, nothing you saw on Sunday was real. Any more than what you're about to see now is real.
I love you.
His natural parents.
No, we were told not to.
We should go.
He'll be home from school soon. You don't want to see him?
I think it best not to.
I understand. He really hates school, you know. Keeps getting those darn A pluses. Aside from that, he's really a wonderful boy. We love him very much.
Yes, I can see that.
Hi, Mom.
I'm just going over to Pops.
Hello.
Dinner's at 7. Don't be late.
Guess what? Got hours 5 to 7.
Fantastic! Where'd you get it?
Well, I traded with Alan Wyman for hours 9 to 11.
You traded Charlie Chaplin?
Just a temporary trip. Come on, you wanna watch?
I'm sure, but your mom's home.
That's okay, we'll play a song. Come on. Oh yeah. And Alan says his brother in Cleveland has the tape where the guy actually shoots himself. He's coming to visit this summer. He said he'll bring it.
Great. Although, I don't know if I really want to watch that. The guy's so great, I'd hate to see him, you know.
Yeah, me too.
Still, I think we gotta watch. He did it so he would.
Next is a dancer named Baryshnikov. He's very special to me. Watching him dance made me see how... Well, watch. Maybe you'll see it too.
Fly.